still be a real Satanist.
Hey everyone, Benji Carver here, your MC and host of Mr. Wholehead's Warped Dimension Film Festival, and I'm so excited to show you from our last night, our final feature film tonight, Flesh City, the director himself, Thorsten Fleisch, all the way from Berlin, Germany, and so thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, how are you? I've watched this movie now twice within a week before we even shown it, just to get myself the sensory deprivation that it is. And I truly enjoy the journey that this film takes us on quite a bit. And thank you for the warning in the beginning. I think our audience appreciates
that. I think I had to do it.
Coming from someone who saw Enter the Void 3 times in theaters, I definitely love that experience. And you also were a technical advisor on that film as well, were you not?
Yeah, I did some of the electricity things, some research that later didn't get used, but then he used like the titles. So I shocked some high voltage through the Enter the Void, the titles, and mm-hmm. that were used for the title animation.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, awesome. And it's great to finally see that you've made your feature film kind of on that level as well. Kind of take us to the journey of where Flesh City came about. I mean, there's a lot of terminology that's there that I thought was really cool, like with cyberpunk, magical nihilism is something that's like its own Max Headroom style. Just kind of take us through sort of the your inception for Flesh City, and then we'll kind of unwrap from there.
I wanted to do a feature film for a long time, and I don't know, I just started with some small script, and finally I had also some actors that would act for me, and I don't know, it came about very organically, I think, and it changed a lot during the journey. It took me probably about 4 years to finish it. And the first thing we shot was the thing in the basement with the record that he listens to with a knife. So at that point, I still thought I'd make a trailer and maybe get some funding and make a film. But then, I don't know, I just moved on step by step. And then the video clips came the idea with the video clips to have this as a common theme.
I think so, in the opening
credit,
you're labeled as VFX creator. How many credits are this in the opening? It's writer, director, VFX, special effects. It was like this like nice block of like, oh, wow, like this is such an organic film in its process. And I think that, and especially as we live in a world where your two characters, you know, these lovers kind of evolve into the digression of technology and all kinds of, you know, niches and markets, you know, I think we definitely identify here in the Warp Dimension quite a bit on that end. Kind of take us through the journey of your video game that occurs in this film.
Sure.
I think I was just thinking, like, I need to put that in the Warp Dimension right now, like, on that end. So.
Yeah, the video game. I made this before, which was also for me a big project. It was only three people, And so it was my brother who did the coding and the kind of the production. I did the graphics, the contents, the story a little bit, and the animation, the music. And then we had a friend, Misha, who did the gameplay, the actual level design and everything. And yeah, we still are big shooter fans, shoot 'em ups, shmups. And yeah, it was great to do our own thing, but it was, of course, also much more work than we thought. So yeah, but I don't know. In the end, we had our game, so that was great.
Yeah, and it's I believe in the credits it said it's available in Xbox One and Wii U as well, so it is actually a real live game, which is very cool.
Every game, exactly. Yeah. But unfortunately the Wii U was kind of dead from the start, which we didn't expect and which was really a pity. And but the Xbox One version still is there, and you can download it, and yeah.
Brilliant. No, I think that's something, again, it's what I talk a lot about here in the Warped Dimension is the organic process of making stuff, not just on your chroma key or, you know, it's sort of in, but actually these are physical, tangible objects that the filmmakers and the creators are bringing to us here.
Yeah, and, yeah. I really like this do-it-yourself approach with anything. I don't know. It's like, of course, when you wear so many hats in a production, then it's not an industry standard by industry standards, but I like that. It has something more poetic reality, or I don't know, it's more personal.
Yeah. I think especially now as we give ourselves into the viral feed quite a bit of the magical nihilism that is in those characters. Kind of get into that story a little bit of how you created that Max Headroom type character.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I thought that it would be a good thing to connect different scenes as a recurring theme, and as music is such a big theme in the film, it was great also to have this video clips, which are themselves like this closed elements in it, and then to have this character in a post MTV thing, which I grew up with. It's, for me, it was very, I don't know, very formative and important at that time. And it's so sad to see that it all went to scripted reality things and no music. And I don't know, it was only this window in time, kind of.
Well, I hope out here we were able to create something like that, that is a kind of a goal. Yeah. On that end, as you see here from our monitors, our TV, I have the net playing in the background, the classic Sandra Bullock film. We have VHS's collection as well back here. So we try to keep things, yeah, like very tangible, especially in that. But at the core of your story is a love story between two very, I would say, honestly fucked up people on that. And sort of kind of coming from there, is that a more biographical approach, or was that more of just sort of like, hey, this is what I just sort of feel like was an entry to this world?
More like an entry to have, I don't know, as the movie is very strange and very hard probably to identify with things, I thought it would be nice to have a little hook for the audience to take that journey, I don't know, that totally disintegrates in the end, so.
we disintegrate into the light, which is the
exactly.
The term I looked it up, they use it, it's like the Curlin theory or something, the Curlin lights. There's the, pardon my,
which my light?
Where was that? I found it here in my research a little bit, but I don't seem to find it here anymore.
No, that's just
the Curlin effects.
Okay. No, that's something with electricity. That's not so much with this film. This is more just an abstract, I don't know, flicker strobing thing as a new life form or new energy, kind of going beyond the cathode ray transmission thing, you know, more into that vein. Yeah, in that vein.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah, no, I just think that that's just something that is, as this world disintegrates, you know, and it's Berlin, right? All of it was shot.
Yeah, all of this is Berlin. Yeah,
all of Berlin and the undergrounds, the tentacles, the creature, the morphing, the mutation. We showed from Portugal last night, Mutant Blast, which is a trauma film.
I've seen clips of it. Yeah.
It's a wild ride. It's like a spaghetti western. So
it's spaghetti western, okay.
Spaghetti western with lobster men and dolphin men and mutants fighting each other. So, but with your film and then this abstract of the tentacles that evolve and attach themselves and then the disintegration of setting until it all becomes a sort of pure sort of lighting. That's what I kind of.
Yeah. It's a pure light vibration. Yeah.
And then of course, and then we just stare off into the void there on that.
Nothing else, exactly.
picking music. A lot of, I know Berlin is a huge underground music scene. It's been for many, many decades. Kind of choices in your music there.
The music, it's mostly I did it myself. It's a few. Some of my friends and then people I met over the years, but most of the music I did myself, actually. Yeah, and I actually come from music. That's before I made films. I was in a band. I was in a metal band in the 90s, late 80s, early 90s. Yeah, a long time ago, you know. Yeah. So, but that's where I come from, playing the guitar, and I have a very musical, rhythmical, and somewhat structural approach also to film, I guess.
Yeah, I think that definitely creates all that, because it's sort of the switchover, but I think it is your influence as a musician, and then and then growing up in the time when MTV did play music videos only.
Yeah, exactly. And I like the video, this video clip aesthetic, where there is a story, but not really. It's very vague, and I like that. It depends, not all the videos, but some really create their own mood and stories.
Yeah,
which are semi-narrative. Yeah,
which is the great thing about independent filmmaking. We can take those avenues off the street and stuff like that as well. Because I think the closest we saw anything of conventional filmmaking might be like Oliver Stone's Natural Born Killers, you know, and that sort of attitude. But I think that's what makes the kind of the power of your film sort of being like, here's this through narrative to get us through it's a love story kind of thing, but then we can take all these avenues kind of thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Have you seen any of the Softies brothers work, like Heaven Knows What or Good Times?
I have seen the last one, the Uncut Gems, and this other one, Good Times, is it? Yeah. I don't know. I think they're all right, but I don't know. I'm more old school, I think, with some of.
No, I think that a lot of your club stuff. One of my favorite movies of all time is Bad Lieutenant, and it reminded me a lot of like that great sequence when he runs through the club and stuff like that. Were you kind of just shooting also in clubs, you know, without like really any permits or anything, just kind of shooting, you know, picking up from there, or was it more stage?
So it's actually two locations. So one location where the video game actually is, that was a friend knew the owner, a little club that doesn't exist anymore, unfortunately, but he knew him and I could have it for a night for very cheap. So that was like rented for the time. But then all these big things, the stage and all these people, that was I was doing a visual for one of the bands that played there. So I asked, hey, could I shoot there? That would be awesome. And he was like, yeah, I don't know, do we have like a big team? Because they didn't want like a lot of attention, they want to focus on the music. I was like, no, I just bring my actor, I don't know, I do some things, would that be all right? He said, yeah, okay. And then so I had kind of a permit to shoot there, but it was like a real show. It's called the Atonale, I think. Atonale in Berlin, which is a cool electronic music festival, and in a great location.
Yeah.
So that was a dream that I could really shoot there and use it as a backdrop for my character. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that, I mean, there's just that scope and that brings into the story, because it's
exactly, it's suddenly there's like 1,000 people. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's just like, I was like, oh, this is some Abel Ferreira stuff going on here. And I get really excited when I see that, like, just run, you know, checking in or not checking in, just like going for it. kind of thing with your camera and your actor. How is the underground scene, or how is the scene in Berlin right now out there in the last year or so?
Yeah, I mean, now Corona, of course, killed a lot. So nobody really knows how which clubs will recover. But also, I'm not an expert, I have to say. You know, I dab in and out a bit, but I'm too old.
Well, I think it's interesting there, because I lived in Vienna for a while back in my early 20s. And so there's definitely like every city in the EU has their own little underground scene. But I know that Vienna right now has, like, they have had gotten another lockdown. There's like a warning. So I know folks are not even allowed to like travel into Vienna right now. So it's a different world out where you're at, but also kind of similar in that way. So I was wondering, how's the art scene out there and whatnot? So
in Berlin, it's I don't know, it's vibrant, I'd say. There's a lot of things going on. You can always do your own thing, but also it doesn't mean the quality is always good. There's, you know, it's very hit and miss, and but you can really do things if you want, and you find also very good people. That's also the thing, that are interested in doing stuff also for no money. Or, you know, I could never have made this film in, like, I don't know, I guess in Munich or in more business oriented cities, where here's everything is very free flowing, and if people are interested in a project, they commit, you know. So I think that's very, very unique for Berlin, probably also for other cities, but in Germany, right, at least.
The hub that is there. It's actually one of the few cities I've actually never been to in the EU. And we'll see if Berlin All happens this year or not in February. But
we'll see. Yeah, I don't know. It's all a big mystery how it will go on with the festivals.
One of my one film that I programmed here called Los Ausentes, from Mexico, a friend of mine's film, that premiered at Berlin last year. So
it was in Berlin and at the Berlinale.
Yeah, it was a short film from Mexico. Yeah. So I've always kind of like, I need to go. Stuff I've worked in the past like has premiered there, and so just have not been at the right time or gotten the plane ticket. So when seeing your movie, I was like, okay, if it's okay, I'll. It's calling to me again. But I think it's interesting is were you able to show this in a feature film format at all, like as a feature on a screen somewhere?
Not yet. No, I had one. There was one festival in Germany, which would have been my German premiere. There's still no German premiere for this movie, but they got canceled, you know, so due to Corona. So that didn't happen. Yeah. And I don't know. So it has been screened a few times in Spain, in some festivals, but I was not there, unfortunately. And it will be in Moscow in October. I hope it will happen. It was supposed to be there in, I think, in March, but then due to Corona, they postponed it to October. So I hope they'll stick to it, but I don't know. It's not over yet with the Corona, so we'll see. But it's a nice little like horror festival, and that'd be cool if they screen it really in a good proper cinema.
Yeah, I think that
for me, it's really made for the cinema. It's really all this flickering intensity. It's much better in the cinema than on your laptop or. But still, I take the streaming. Anyway, you know, it's better than nothing.
I mean, it's probably picked it as the closing night film. I think it enwraps a lot what we've been showing here over the last six nights here in the Warped Dimension. I mean, we're broadcasting, you know, somewhere outside of San Francisco, in the underground of Zoom webinar. So on that end, but I definitely want to seek that out. I would love to see it in a theater. I mean, mentioned before, I saw Enter the Void 3 times in a theater. Yeah. I mean, I do seek out Gasper's work, you know, in a theater. I think it's designed for that. I think your film is definitely that kind of film. Pride myself being, I saw Love in 3D in a theater, which
me too. Yeah, here in Berlin. Yeah,
I saw it in Vienna actually. The last time I was there, they were playing it on there. So yeah, I think that that's something that's very special with this film, that you are, you know, you're working in a lot of the genre, a lot of homages, but also making it this very, very, you know, important piece that should be seen in a cinema. And I think, and to see also the experiences of, you know, people's like sensory, are they able to like
take
in that, especially the last like 10 minutes of the movie, or, you know,
I've seen some of my shorter films, which are also sometimes on the very, very intense flickery side. So I always enjoy them, to really see the audience reaction when they're like, yeah, I don't know, they have to like breathe in first after that, because it was something that they have not expected and have not seen so much before. And I like that. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I think it's so important. Cause yeah, I remember again, like I think when Netflix released Enter the Void, like, oh yeah, I watched that. It's a little too long. Like, and I'm like, you didn't see in a theater. Like, it's the whole other experience on that. But I think also with this film though too, is that it, where we're at as a society watching everything on our screens, it does give an extra layer to it, I think, as we've kind of all been locked into the Zoom. So, I mean, it's like kind of this, you know, important thing, like, please let me know.
It works with the whole like network of channels and the overstimulation and all that. Yeah. the constant screen onslaught.
Well, I think it's great, because I'm like, I grew up, like a little bit after the late 90s, early 2000, you know, kind of MTV when that transition. But I kind of I got to see on some underground TV, a little bit local access TV. I'm really obsessed with that kind of stuff. And that kind of.
Yeah, there's a documentary about, I think it's called TV Party, this New York channel from the 80s with like, I don't know, Basquiat's in it and Blondie, I don't know, it's really funny. It's and it has great Blondie calls it like toxic editing, which I really like. So they're just like randomly cutting between the cameras, and it has this really, I don't know, it's non-human editing, because it's really jerky and jarring. I really like that. Yeah.
And the disruption stuff like that, pirate. We showed some films like Pirate Disney, I kind of call it now, where people are, you know, shooting under, you know, shooting what it looks like they're vacation films, but they're really Disney films and stuff like that. But they're all about like the darker edges of society. And I think, but getting back to like the studio kind of stuff. Do you remember a show called Squirt TV at all? That was an MTV era where it was this
Liquid,
one kid's
Liquid
name.
Liquid TV.
Sorry, what was that?
Liquid TV, I remember. Wasn't it Liquid TV?
Liquid TV is the animation one. There was another one, this kid, and I can't remember his name right now. People will probably be like, oh, it's so-and-so. He'd interview, he was in his teen years living in New York, and he would get like celebrity and filmmakers and artists, and he'd just interview them in his bedroom. Kind of thing, he'd just have them come over. Jake Fogelnest, that was his name. Like that. So that's kind of the quality that I really identify with your film, and then with what we're doing over here. It's sort of the joke. It's like, oh yeah, everyone come to my room and let's talk for a minute. So kind of thing. So from that, you know, you made this, you know, you've made short films, you've made with Flesh City, being a musician in the metal scene in the late 90s. Sorry, I do not know more. There's probably like, what about this? What about that? Like, I'm like, you know, it's like, that's kind of the cool thing with the live audience that we do when we show here. That there's a lot more older audience members who kind of might know more of the niche kind of stuff. I'll be chatting and stuff like that. I'll definitely send you any comments and or questions that our audience will be asking. Tonight.
Definitely appreciate that. Great.
I think it's just it just shows me like what the power of it is and how you somehow found your way to the warp dimension with Flesh City in a lot of ways. The Flesh City warp dimension sound very much like the
through some wormhole, you know, some loop fabric of time and space.
Lives within the Flesh City or something like that. You know, it's and jokingly say, yeah, like we're 667, we're next door to the beast, you know, 666. So, you know.
Yeah, okay, yeah. You're one step ahead. You know?
Yeah, yeah. So, we're on even planes. They're next door. You know, we don't even know who Mr. Holehead is, actually. He just, I built this for him, and then I never said hello. So kind of thing like that.
He never paid you a visit, yeah.
He has not paid a visit yet. I've had other visits though from other characters. Something that we've done here since we're kind of trying to get like names like Tom Green or someone, you know, just to see if they might retweet back. And so I was kind of inspired, like, well, what did Tom Green do? It was like he just created his own characters. So I just started creating characters that I call like my cousin or someone I found in the warp dimension, and you know, you dress up and act like a maniac for 5 minutes and then and run away. Kind of very good. So hopefully you'll tune in actually more, because we're going to be doing starting in October VHS surprise nights. So we're digitizing a bunch of VHS tapes. It'll be horror for October mainly, but what we do is my friend and I and George and Romany, well, those are the several people together. My friend Craig, he's like a big VHS head, so he has a lot of obscure stuff that he's been cutting, and he's been with VHS collectives over the years. So what we're doing is we're adding a bunch of like commercials from like the era that you just find on your tapes that we found. And then little special like moment. And then we're going to have a feature film that we can't say what it is exactly, but it'll pop on. And it's we got the tracking and everything. So it's so hopefully you'll be able to tune in on that at some point.
Yeah. Keep me in the loop. Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. And so the other thing is, you had a festival that it did play at Morbido,
in Mexico. Yeah. Oh, is it Mexico? I actually don't know. But in Mexico, of course. Yeah, yeah, Mexico. Yeah. That was nice, but I couldn't go, unfortunately. It's a bit too far, but I would have loved to go, to see it with a bigger audience. Yeah. Yeah, they had played really in the cinema, so that was probably a good screening.
Yeah, no, that would have been a great. Yeah, I've been wanting to see something there for the last few years. At that, that's one of the biggest like horror festivals in Mexico. So, so when I saw that on your laurels, I was like, oh yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one to see there. How are you been with Flesh City? I know we're trying to get it to, you're trying to get it to a cinema still. But what are some projects you've been maybe possibly working on or been talking about in the style of that?
I'm just shooting a new short with the same actor, with Christian Serratiello, who plays Viren in Flesh City. He plays again one character. Then also Marilena Netzka, who plays Womb Envy, the performer, she plays in it. And then Bruce Woolley, who's not in this film, Australian actor. And it's a short. It's again like sci-fi horror. It's a bit more narrative driven, I think. The script writing was a bit more elaborate. And yeah, something with like an AI and it goes wrong and everybody's dead in the end. And also a lot of visual. I want this machine aesthetic, machine learning thing in it. And so I've already shot the most part. This weekend I'm gonna shoot the last part with Marilena in Paris. Also again, some brutalist architecture, which I like, which I used a lot in Flesh City. And now I'm using it's on the outskirts of Paris. It's called Ivry, and it's a super great designed urban neighborhood thing, super brutal with all the weird angles and concrete and but mostly it's all indoors. And again, I used my own apartment for most of the scenes, so just remodeled some things.
I mean, that's what you got to do out there. Can you go a little bit into the brutalist architecture a little bit, because that's something I think that is very unique to your work a little bit on that?
Yeah, but I just like it. I like this retro futuristic style that it brings. And there are some cool buildings in Berlin. Berlin is not per se like a pretty city or architecturally, like Vienna, for example. Vienna is like a time capsule. I don't know, everything fits together very nicely. It's all, nothing has been destroyed. And in Berlin, it's a lot has been destroyed. And there's a lot of different styles and ugly parts, beautiful parts, and these brutalist gyms, you know, which I really like, that I wanted to have in the film. So some of the scenes are motivated by the buildings. I wanted to shoot something in front of the building, you know.
Yeah, it's a another term would be like, yeah, post-apocalyptic architecture. Kind of thing. Yeah, from that, because Vienna is like, it's like a circle. That's all Vienna is. It's like, you know, how it's designed. And
yeah, and it's like it's a time travel to 150 years back. Yeah,
it definitely is. It's the Schönbrunn and stuff like that. Like, you go out there, it's just like, okay, like, yeah, I'm standing in some in a different time in a different place and stuff like
that. Yeah, there's like sculptures in front of the normal houses. I don't know. I find this really wow. Yeah. It's very beautiful. Yeah,
because there's something there. It's like, and I saw also with Flesh City is I would run in the parks quite a bit, and then these like watchtowers, these big towers that are just there.
Yeah, you know, it's the one thing that he circles, that Chris circles, is a ventilation thing. You know, it vents out air for some other building that we didn't see in the movie.
Yeah, I mean, but then we go into the underground and into the avenues and the canals and the creepy and the crawlies and stuff like that, which I think.
Yeah, exactly. That's like the tunnels and the buildings. Yeah.
Well. Well, it's I think it's just something that's really special with your feature here, and it's such a pleasure to have it as a closing night film.
Thank you. I'm very happy. Yeah.
And kind of maybe talk a little bit about, also before we go, about your actors a little bit. How do you choose your actors? Working with them.
So a lot of the actors I knew from another project many years ago. I co-produced a film by an American, actually, Philip Duncan. Who another friend, another American, he brought him to Berlin to shoot this film. Also a feature, it's called Love Songs for Scumbags, also with a lot of music that the director many years before made. And so we made this movie. I was like really super involved in the production. And I don't know. So I knew some actors from there. And then my main actor Chris, he has many actors friends. He brought some in, so yeah, it's more like by personal connection mostly that I found the actors that were willing to work for the film. You know,
yeah, because I think it's interesting. Being a filmmaker myself and being in the EU, it's a different world. I'm from the States, and finding, you know, actors out there, because I always think of theater groups. You know, that's usually kind of a good source. That is there, but also what you're trying to achieve. And also just, it's your personal connections at the end of the day. A lot of times you find outside the United States, non-actors, I think, are always there's a flexibility in the filmmaking industry, usually, of using more non-actors. Like my friends in Mexico, they use quite a bit. I think that's something that is there. And I really, again, hope this gets to be in a cinema, and you can talk to tell us about the reactions people had and stuff like that as well. And the experience of seeing all that light and the disintegration of, you know, kind of where we are as society, but yet as a new wave.
New world is coming.
Yeah, we're all connected to some wires here and stuff like that. Our producer and I call man behind the curtain, George. You know, we've had a couple times in the festival where things just all of a sudden just crash, and he's got to like flip around, you know, real quickly. And I'm like, oh, he's even more connected. On that end, and it's like, but it's been a great ride, and we're still going to be doing this, and I hope we can make Flesh City, you know, a part of that as well. So
definitely great.
I'm Benji Carver, MC host of Mr. Holehead's Warp Dimension, out here inside the Warp Dimension. I've been stuck inside for 6 days, but Thorsten has Thorsten Fleisch here has so graciously stopped by here in the Warp Dimension to talk about his feature film Flesh City. If you're listening out there, get into a theater. I know we need to be safe and cautious, but I think it's definitely worth it. But if you can't, connect yourselves into the wires and the webs, open those eyeballs like Alex in A Clockwork Orange and definitely check it out. It will definitely remind you of that. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.